And argumentation, because that's what my research is on. Today, I'm going to talk about supporting reading, which is invisible, very hard to notice because it doesn't seem to be there. But it really is fundamental, as we see when we look at other media. And it's also important to science. Faculty spend 150 hours a year just reading. That's not counting finding the things to read. And that's about 3 hours a week. Over the past 30 years, people in science have been reading more quickly and more broadly. But how they read and what they read, it depends on what they're trying to do and what the context is. So in terms of the 30-year history, you can see that here. So since 1977, the percentage of articles that people that read a year has nearly doubled. In the same time, the amount of time people are spending reading is not increasing overall, and per article, that's decreasing. So one thing we need to be thinking about is how can we free people from reading? What are some of the tasks that people are doing in reading, and can we do those in other ways? I like to think about the history of the book, and I go back to Eisenstein, who wrote this wonderful book about the printing press as an agent of change in early modern Europe. And that's about the printing press as a piece of technology. We've talked a little bit about the history of journals going only back to 1660. And it's even more impressive to me to think that it's only 500 years that we've had books as printed objects. And it's not even really correct to say that they've been printed objects like we know them that whole time, because things like indices and tables of contents, those are actually small little invisible technologies that had to develop. That kind of gives me hope, because they just seem completely, you know, how could you do anything without you know, page numbers or titles and, you know, title pages and tables of contents. So I want to talk a little bit about some kinds of reading. I started out when I wrote the abstract for this talk with three of them. I've now got five, and some of them are related to one another and blend into one another. And I'm especially interested in hearing feedback from people about the extent to which these kinds of reading ring true to your own experience and what you see with other people you observe around you. Again, it's hard to observe other people's reading because it's not something that you know, we may very well do it in public, but we don't expect to be stared at when we're reading. And if people are, you know, watching us, trying to be surreptitiously watching us, that, you know, we get a little bit nervous. So the five types of reading that I want to talk about are active reading, just-in-time reading, the sort of video game trance that we go through when we're finding things, reading avoidance, and possibly something that came up in the last session this morning, not reading, that may be one reason that the PDFs are popular. So for active reading, I'm talking about annotation and skimming and scanning and the fact that you don't read something in linear order. So this is my iPhone. In the past 2 years, I've read about 100 books on it. I don't think I'm that abnormal. It's, you know, you can come look at it later if you don't have a good e-reader on your own favorite mobile. But for me, this is something that linear stuff, you just press your thumb and there's the next page and you just keep going through. So for novels, that's great. But for scientific papers, this is a really small screen size, in part because we've got diagrams and tables and all sorts of things, and in part because we don't tend to read linearly. We read, you know, maybe look at the title and the affiliation, maybe look at the abstract, flip through, look at the figures, look at the conclusion. Often, at some point throughout this process, figuring out that we found out enough about this paper, we don't need to read it. We may want to print it and file it for later. We may want to forward it to a colleague. We may want to think, okay, I'm sorry I even opened that wasn't relevant at all. Or we may decide to, you know, it's worth fully looking at. So that's this notion of active reading. The notion of just-in-time reading is, and I'd really like to know if people can tell me whether they do this. But Sometimes I find when I'm writing something, I have a couple questions that I think, surely somebody's answered this question already. I need to at least look and see if I can find an answer really quickly and get to that. So I look at the literature, I see if I can find answers to questions. And also, I have to keep up and see if there's new stuff at the end of the process. So those are these first two. And let me pause there because I've got a slide about active reading. This is an idea that I got off of Jean Galensky, who blogs about it a bit, and it came up, the idea of active reading, in part by comparing what you do when you're passively reading something, as I was talking about, my novel on my cell phone, versus actively annotating and going through and writing on something, and comparing passive to active and single text to multiple texts. Then he's also talking about this transition between reading and writing and retrieval, which then gets back to that kind of just in time reading that I haven't heard other people talk about. I hope other people are talking about, and maybe you can tell me later if that's something you do. So then I've got from Ellen Rainier, who was one of my master's advisor at UIUC when I was a library student there, two ideas that are, I think, closely related. One of them is this video game-like engagement that we have with literature, where you're sifting through stuff and trying to track citations back and forth, finding the open access copies, very quickly deciding whether something is relevant or not, and maybe not even at the end of that process reading a single paper or even printing a single paper to read later, but just trying to engage in that way with the literature. He's compared it to a young girl flicking a remote control and the annoyed father looking in the background and saying, "What are you doing? Why can't you make up your mind about what channel you're going to watch?" And the girl says that she's watching all the channels. So there's this kind of vertical engagement. So the notion of reading avoidance, I think, has become more prominent. It's always been around. We've used abstracts and indices and citations and summaries that other people give of their research. Now we're doing text mining and data mining, which is really exciting. And we also just heard about the way that we recognize the structure of texts and that helps. So avoiding reading is really interesting. And then in terms of PDFs, there are plenty of reasons that we use PDFs as is, but one of them is definitely printing for not reading, I think. Somebody else I've been really influenced by is Kathy Marshall. She's got a great book here that I recommend to people about reading and writing the electronic book. She talks about reading being mobile, interactive, social, and material. And from that, I want to say that digital scholarship should be all those four things. We want portable formats that are reflowable. I like EPUB, just some HTML and friends and tasty zip package. We need something that's interactive so we can annotate, so we can choose the reading order. We need something that's social to be able to remix and reuse and share. And Aaron Rowe was saying earlier that when his favorite people submit a paper or have one accepted, he wants an automatic notification like you would get on Facebook. And I absolutely want that too. Finally, we don't tend to think about papers as very material, but typography and design really do matter. And that's part of what's going on with the PDF. And we do use body memory and spatial memory. In general, there's just a lot of complex stuff going on when we read. And when we're talking about going beyond the PDF, I hope that's an opportunity for us to understand and support this. And finally, just to plug, my own work is in the social semantic web, and I think that's going to be really relevant to reading in the future. And particularly one of my collaborators asked me to plug a workshop that's going to be at ESWC, so submit to SePublica. I would be happy to then discuss either now or later any of these things.
Thanks for that. One question?
You may have come across David Levy's writing about the University of Washington. He did some really nice work on studying reading and you know, what you do in a subway, what a monk does, poring over the same page again and again.
Yeah, is that scrolling forward that he's doing, or maybe that's...
Not sure.
Yeah.
I imagine you might have come. Yeah, I recommend it if you haven't. David Levy has done some really brilliant work on modes of reading.
More of a comment than a question, but maybe you have some comments about this. I think it's important to consider in this context and in all the other contexts we've talked about people with disabilities, either blind or deaf or other things, and how we engage them in whatever products we produce that are associated with this.
Yeah, and that's something that several people on Twitter have been wanting to get out into the room, so I'm glad you brought it out.
Anybody else got a question at this stage? Yep.
I don't know if I heard you correctly in your first, you know, introduction, is that the average scientist spend 3 hours a week reading? Did I hear you right?
So that's the actual statistics that I said was 150 hours a year, and that comes from research by Carol Tenapier. And the numbers that she has there are 143 to 159 hours just reading, and the medical faculty, it's 168 hours. So I've got, at the end of my slides here, I've got some references. One is on spatial memory, because somebody asked about that yesterday, and others are some of these here. And I think if you look on SlideShare, my references are in the notes as well.
Okay, thanks for that. We can come back to it. Okay.